Hello guys, welcome to my channel. So this is my part 2 of my collaboration with Sean from Little Red Jungle. So this video will cover 6 different topics. How to spot them. Diet. Diversity. Anatomy. Mechanism of gliding. And behind the scenes. This video is gonna be very long, so please be sure to check out the timestamp below in the description box. And with that, let's begin with how to spot the Draco. Draco is a diurnal species, and diurnal means that they are active during the day. They rarely open up their butter jar unless in flight or stretching after flight, which is only sometimes in our observation, which make them hard to admire. These Dracos are incredibly fast. Their flight times are in seconds or even in a split second. These footage have been slowed down by 80% to just to give you an idea of how fast they are. They can be found in urban areas near to the forest. Forest areas and mature forests. In our experience of spotting these Dracos on different trees, we realize that they have a preference for a certain texture, like the trees behind me. So starting with this one, it's like one of the maximum girth that they have a preference for, because some of the trees in Singapore and Southeast Asia can get a lot larger, and so they have a preference for a somewhat smooth bark that is easy for them to run up and away from danger. So I have a selection of different girths that you can see. This is some of the place that you can find the Draco on. And if we look closely up the tree, you will see some shape that are sticking out and breaking the silhouette of the tree.
So look out for these things that might be sticking out the tree trunk, like this one. Breaking the tree silhouette. They can be camouflaged very well, so you definitely need patience to scan through the tree trunk and distinguish them from the tree. And you can see pattern or shape that might be odd. It actually applies to most of the animals when you are spotting them.
The diet of dragons. They primarily eat ants that which constitute to 98 to 100% of your diet, but they also eat other small invertebrates like millipedes, bugs, termites, larvae, scale insects, and beetles. However, it's not certain if they eat certain species of ants. They can be picky with food as observed in captivity. So they will look for the ant trails. So they will look for and also even revisit some of the ant trails where they will be treated to buffets of ants. Look at that, they can even be startled by your own prey item.
There's a study on the diet on the Dracos pilopterus, which is an endemic species from Philippines. They did an analysis of the gut content and there were 13 genera of ants. There are 3 species of Draco lizards in Singapore. First is the Sumatran gliding lizard and the black bearded gliding lizard, which is more inside the forest. And the rare species is the 5-banded gliding lizard. So there are a total of 3 species in Singapore. But there are 40 described species in the world. 39 of them can be found in Southeast Asia. They come in various sizes and color patterns. Some of the notable ones are like the Draco Ornatus is from Philippines, Draco Maximus from Malaysia, Thailand and Indonesia, Draco Zuzimiri from India, and Draco Plumflori is from the Indo-Chinese region of Southeast Asia. So there are very few images of very rare species that are very highly endemic to search some of the islands in Philippines and Indonesia especially. So we based on the black and white description, we try to form out what the actual creature looks like based on the Batachium or the dewlap, or because some of the dorsal patterns are variable and hard to distinguish.
There are also very little breeding knowledge of this creature, with the most commonly kept species overseas is Draco maculatus. While we are building the base of knowledge, I feel that it's important to carry on so we can potentially save a species in the future when in a time of need. In one of my trips, I actually saw the adult and a baby in very close proximity of each other. And so the little one is visibly very small and are mini natures of the adult.
This segment, that when we are discussing the anatomy of Draco, could be very long for some of you, and some of the terms that I use may be a little too scientific. So you are free to skip this part and get to mechanism of gliding. This is the diagram that I drew an illustration of the Draco. It's a local species in Singapore. Draco quickly fascicatus, which is the five bender. The five bend, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And I did the diagram to point out some of the parts of the lizard. We have the head and the dewlap that, you know, is plays a very important part in communication and the behavior known as flagging. So that's the dewlap or the gula flag. And the two sides is leopards, which is quite prominent in the female without the dewlap. But both sexes have the leopards. And then this is the forelimb that will be holding onto the leading edge of the Batachium as while it's in flight. And we have the thoracic ribs, so these are actually extended ribs from the body out to form the composite wing, and the membrane over here that is between the ribs. We have different type of muscles, but this is not all of it because I've not covered the rest of the lizard because there's a lack of information about that. So based on the Batachium, we have the trapezius, which is between the arms. Actually, if you look closely at some of my footage again, you see that this part is actually moving. I'm not really sure whether is it the heart beating or is the breathing. But it could be either or both. And we have the Elostelis maho, which is quite the anterior side of the Batachium, and ligament attaching from different ribs and intercostal muscles and longissimus dorsi, which is dorsum. The dorsal part of the body. And so if you see that there's much more muscles around this side, probably because in order to extend, the first muscle will be coming out together with the leading, that is forming the leading edge. And then the rest will connect and follow as it opens the wing, near the ligament from the second rib to the fifth. Elastin is a type of a protein that is elastic that helps to connect the issues. Well, the elastin basically looks like this. The whole thick bands in the sand, in the middle, and along the edge of the pterygium. And you have the costal cartilage and the collagen just bend along this side. So that's two different part system that forms the pterygium. So that's about it for the anatomy of the dragon lizard.
So we will begin on breaking down the mechanism on how dragon fly, and Sean will be my demonstrator at the back. Firstly, the dragon will look around in the surrounding tree and choose which tree that it wants to land or glide to, and also avoiding any potential predators that might be in the vicinity. So, first, you will leap off the tree and opens up his pterygium and using his four legs to grip onto the edge of the pterygium, and that forms the composite wing, and it begins its descent. And after that, during the midway, it will arch it back to reduce the drag and slow the fall. And upon reaching the tree that it wants to land, it will let go of his pterygium and use his four legs reaching out to the tree first and landing with a thud. So this whole process actually happened very fast, even in a split second.
So this is the diagram that I also illustrated, and there are four different phases: the initial takeoff jump, the acceleration, and gliding and landing. So you can pause the figure and then you can have a look. So as we are walking down the path, we saw the dragon on this tree. It was about 2 meters from the ground. And after some of the jogger walked past, it climbed higher up the tree. So now we are waiting for it to glide. Yeah, over here you can see there's one. It basically looks like a stick, but if I were to take from the side view, you can see it breaking the tree silhouette.
Yeah, I think it was very difficult trying to film the Dracos because they're very fast and timid creatures, right? So whenever you lift up the cameras and point it towards them, then they spot you, then they get scared and then they run away. So it's actually very hard to get a good footage of the Dracos.
Yeah, and also these dragons are incredibly fast. They are gliding in split second, almost like falling from height. And so we are using long lens, the zoom, and manual zoom focus. And Sean don't even have the tripod at some of the times.
I have tripod.
You don't have? You were using handheld like that?
I have tripod, I just never use.
You decided not to use the tripod and you decided to use handheld. Decided to do that.
Okay, I think I handheld some of my shots because what Kenneth said previously, you know, sometimes we have to really go out to a 90 degree angle to film the Dracos, and then, you know, if your tripod isn't good enough or it's a bit weak, or sometimes, you know, you just can't find the right shot. And you know, it's very hard, especially since, you know, they're very timid and you have to move fast, right? So I decided that instead of I want to waste time and adjust, might as well just go handheld and be very calm and stable and try to stabilize the camera as best as I can. Yeah.
So they are, will you say that they are unpredictable?
Yeah, they're very unpredictable. Sometimes, and the problem is, the tree is here, right? You don't know if they will jump and glide this side, or jump and glide this side, jump glide backwards. It'll glide anywhere, right? So even if you station and cam down there and put your camera there and just wait for it to glide, doesn't mean you get the shot, right? Sometimes you'll just, you know, go a different direction.
Yeah, so they can possibly go out. But actually, the point that I want to bring up is that they are unpredictable, like, when in the times where they decide to fly.
Yeah.
So there are times when they move, we check our camera footage,
they disappear from the frame, but they actually are climbing upwards or they are flying out. And there are a few times where we see them climbing upwards, and after that, as we are adjusting to bring our lens up, they fly in the midst of adjustment. So we have lost our great opportunity after how many days of filming. We found one that is the most outermost branch, and such an open area here that we can shoot it from the above. But as we were adjusting our camera, we missed the opportunity. So it's such a waste.
Such a waste. Such a waste. Such a waste.
So, even that black bearded guardian lizard that after the flight, it landed on one of the trees and it stretched its parachium in front of us. It's almost like how many meters? 3 meters? 5 meters?
It was quite pretty near, yeah.
Yeah, it was pretty near.
And but wasn't prepared. I was prepared because I handheld. So sorry, so I got the shot. He wasn't prepared.
Probably there's a pro and con of using handheld and using frame. That time I was using the kit lens. I was using the wide angle, so I had to change the lens, and it takes time in order to show that I witnessed this opening of the parachium, and I didn't get it on footage. But luckily I had Sean with me that time. He managed to get some of the footage that you saw in the video.
Okay, but to be honest, it's very tough because my lens is very heavy. I'm using a super it's not really a super long lens, but it's a long enough lens that's pretty heavy. Arms day, basically. I was just like that, trying not to move and keeping very still, and while this guy is still preparing his lens. Oh wait. So it was a very fun and eventful day that day. Yeah.
Yeah, so how many days did we spend to film this video?
Oh man, I think actual days trying to film the Dracos, we 4 or 5 days, right?
Yeah,
I think around four or five days. And then there's one day where we just present to you, so a bit of behind the scenes. The presentation is not on the actual day itself, we do it separately. So a total of maybe about a week of filming. Yeah, just for two people. Yeah, so all the footages you see is two of us in this span of a week. Yeah.
Comparing our footage with the documentaries, they have like more men and more cameras, and maybe high quality footage as well. So they are able to crop all this.
Yeah.
And still looks very high quality.
Yeah, but I mean, I'm still proud of our shots.
Yeah.
I think for a span of a few days, I think we managed to capture them gliding, I think opening up the patagium, and or even mating. We saw a courting ritual, which will be, I think, in my side. I don't know if you're having it on your side of the video. We're having it on his side as well. But they were chasing, and then they were showing the dewlap, and basically showing the full display of the courting ritual. Yeah.
Yeah, that's That's all for sharing of our behind the scenes, and thank you for sticking around and listening to our stories. That I thought it would be interesting that you have an insight of all this, how difficult it is to actually predict all the behavior that we observe in the wild, and filming with such heavy equipment, especially with tripod, with my lens, my camera, and he has so many bags around him.
Yeah, I have like three, four bags.
Yeah, and then his lens cannot even fit into one of his bags. So he had to also struggle with carrying different.
Okay, it wasn't a struggle. It seems like a struggle, but I got it. I got it all under control. Got it in control. Yeah.
Alright. Thank you, man.